Thank you so much for being here and encouraging us by your presence tonight. And we know we have several who are following online with the live stream. And we welcome you to the 43rd Southside Lectures. Brother Tim Stevens is going to lead us in 30 minutes of singing as we join our voices together and praise and magnify our great God. Let's join together as he leads us.
The Glory Land Way be our first song.
Glory.
This will be new to many of you. No idea. So, just want you to know right up front. But they're very effective.
Yeah.
103, I believe. And he wrote that psalm, my understanding, the night that his wife passed away. I've done so much of that over the past year for my dear wife. I have cried out. I mean, I have really cried out. Being outside by myself early in the morning, crying out, hear my prayer. Heal this girl. Not if you can, I know you can. He has the power. And we continue to pray for complete healing. And her being here this year, did not expect that a year ago. As I said on Sunday evening, doctors gave her no hope of surviving, but our great physician did. And he continues. He continues to be with us as we approach him and we petition him. And I'm stronger as a result of all of this. When someone asked me if it had been a test of my faith, I said, I never thought of it as a test of my faith. I found it as an opportunity to grow in my faith. And I believe we all can experience that, and some of you have. But we must never give up. Never give up. He is there for us. That song just really got to me. I have two more. I kind of cut it short last night by about 4 minutes, and I received a little bit of criticism over that. So I'll make up for it. It wasn't really too terrible of the criticism, but I didn't get any Cracker Jacks today. I know that. Well, no, I take it back. I did a few moments ago. Thanks to Veronica. All right. I hold his hand. Two more songs here.
Thank you.
Melissa and I sit behind Tim and Vicky, and I can tell you the singing is better because Vicky's here. She can sing. And the preaching is better because of answered prayers for Jordan Schouse this year. I want you to think about how many times Jesus was asked a question, and sometimes it was a trap question, and sometimes it was a legitimate question. And think of how often the Lord responded, "Have you not read the scriptures?" He pointed them back to what was written. And I don't want the significance of this to be lost on you this week. We have different generations represented by the preachers on this program. But what brings them all together are the scriptures. Each one of them is interested in what says the scripture. Jordan Schouse will be speaking first tonight on what the scriptures say about the promise of God. Brother Stevens will have another hymn, and I'm going to ask Tim Jennings if he will lead a prayer after the song, and then we'll hear from Jordan Schouse. And Tim, I'm going to ask you to remember tonight our co-laborer, David Tomley. David is to have open heart surgery in the morning in Birmingham. To our members, you'll remember he's the father of Christy Coffin. And our prayers should be with David and his family as he'll have a very serious surgery and then a long recovery in the hospital. So we'll have one more song in the prayer and then our first lecture for tonight.
For you have promised. Together. Our great God, Creator, our Father,
So thankful to be able to come into your presence and to say thank you for being a God who has revealed yourself to us. You have revealed yourself in so many beautiful and meaningful ways. As we look at your creation, we see your beauty in all the things that you have made, in the order that you have created to show us that you are a holy God. But we are especially thankful today for your word, which reveals to us through its commandments, its precepts, its promises, the kind of God that you are, a God of holiness and righteousness, a God of mercy and grace. But most of all, Father, we're thankful that you have revealed yourself in the flesh through your Son, Jesus Christ. And in him we see grace and truth. In him we see your wonderful character. In him we see your love that went to the depths of suffering and dying in our place so that we can be with you. Oh, gracious Father, thank you for revealing yourself to us. We do not serve a God that we do not know. We serve a God who has spoken. Thank you for being such. And as we understand you, oh God, we know that you love us so much. You know the very number of hairs on our head. You know the thoughts and intents of our hearts. Everything is naked and open before you. And so, Father, we know that you know the concerns of our hearts tonight. We pray that you will be with David Tomley as he's facing a serious surgery tomorrow. You know, Father, how much he loves you and how much he has served your people here and around the world. And we pray, Father, for your healing hand to be on him. We pray for the doctors and nurses, all that's being done for him, so that he might live, so that he might continue to serve and honor you and spread the knowledge of you across the world. We thank you for Jordan today who comes before us with your word. Fill him with boldness and courage today, Father, and open our hearts wide so that we might hear. Because we long to look like you. We long to be conformed to your image. We pray, Father, you'd knock off any kind of selfishness and doubt and sinful thoughts within us and fill us with who you want us to be. May it be to your praise and glory today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Good evening, everyone. In our Bibles, we're going to be in Psalm 46, and I invite you to make your way in your text to that chapter tonight, Psalm 46. I overheard in a conversation already this week, the preaching has been good, the singing has been really good, and that has been the case. Worshiping together with each one of you, there are some who are here from a lot of different places across this country, and joining together in our common love for the Lord, our common faith in Him, our common victory in the Savior is something special and precious. Our sister Vicki, you are a testimony to God's goodness, to the fact that God has given us a reason to sing, and we're going to sing, and we're going to give thanks for all of His goodness. It's been a blessing to be with you. We're so thankful for each one of you who are here tonight on a Tuesday evening. Could be some from a lot of different places, and we're thankful that we're here to open the Word of God, to encourage one another, and to spend time asking the question, confidently leaving with, what does the Scriptures say? I have to confess, I made a mistake yesterday. I had announced publicly the preachers that my daughter favors over myself. And she boldly proclaimed in the car today, Russ Bowman is the champion of preachers. But Ken and David, don't be alarmed, because she said, don't worry, the three of you can still get a trophy. Participation trophy for showing up. That's... It does get worse, because my middle son, Noah, chimed in it, and he said, I took notes on Mr. Russ's sermon. Take this with you. It could help you tonight. I thought, I might as well sit down. So before we go to bed, we're going to talk about bad company corrupting good morals. And now, Mr. Ken talked about growth, and it was a great lesson, so I'm going to do some growing tonight, growing in grace. I'm thankful for their love for the truth and their love for the men who preach the truth. What does the scripture say about facing hard times? That's a question, isn't it? What does the scripture say about enduring life storms? About drawing strength and confidence when times are hard? We're looking tonight at one specific promise. We just sang there are many promises that the Lord has made and proven faithful in those promises. But tonight, I want us to look to the lens of Psalm 46 and to take away one promise, one sure, steadfast, powerful, and enduring promise that will make all the difference in our lives. We're in Psalm 46, beginning in verse 1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth should change, and though the mountains slip into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains quake at its swelling pride. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy dwelling places of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She will not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations made an uproar. The kingdoms tottered. He raised his voice. The earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Come behold the works of the Lord, who has wrought desolations in the earth. He makes wars to cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariots with fire. Cease striving, be still, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Amen. I don't know the particular setting which prompted the writing of this song, of this psalm, and I believe that's probably on purpose. That the intention of these words and the absence of their background is to remind us that these words, these powerful words, can apply to the people of God in any and every circumstance they find themselves in. And it doesn't take long. Verse 2, and he opens the eyes of the readers to the serious challenges the people of God face on our journey from here to home. And you notice the language he uses in verse 2, it's not like a minor inconvenience. The splinters of life that get into our skin. He talks about earthquaking, about seas roaring, about mountains falling. And you take that and we pull it to today and we see it through our lens about the serious challenges you and I face in this broken world. The inward struggle of doubt and fear and anxiety and depression and worry and grief. The battle in our society for the homes, broken homes, divorce, fighting, and abuse. You think about, even in this world, the darkness and the evil and the crimes, the wickedness, the working of Satan around us. Can you feel the tension in verse 2 when he says, in the midst of things that seem so uncertain and shaking and rocking you at your very core, what catches my attention is that in the midst of all of that, he began by saying, I will not be afraid. That even in the most frightening and serious and challenging situations the people of God can find them is, there is a greater courage and a greater strength that can see them through. And that's what I want us to draw out today. There's a promise that's at the root of this psalmist's courage. And there's three things from the psalm that shows why it is, even in hard times, we need not be afraid. The first of which he opens with is the presence that is unwavering. There's a word that's repeated in verse 2 and in verse 3, and it's the word though. Though the earth should change, though the mountains slip, though the waters roar and foam, though the mountains quake, he is saying, even though these terrible times will come, they're not going to be the final chapter in your story. They're not the last thing. They don't have the last say and the last voice, because there existed a greater strength and a greater power before they came, and that greater strength and power will be with you long after they have ended. And that greater strength is the Lord who is with us. The emphasis in verses 1 through 3 is not how strong the storms are. The emphasis is on how strong our God is. Listen again to verse 1. Did you notice the word? The Lord is our refuge and strength, a very present help. It's not from trouble, it's in. Did you catch that? In trouble. And so when friends forsake us and our neighbors turn against us and our brethren can't be by our side and the world turns its back on us, there is never a time in which the people of God can confidently say, where's God in the midst of this storm? Where is God when I need him the most? Paul was the one who said that even though he was forsaken. And my first defense, he says in 2 Timothy 4 and verse 16, no one supported me, but all deserted me, may not be counted against them. But the Lord stood with me, and he strengthened me, in order that through me the proclamation might be fully accomplished, and that all the Gentiles might hear, and I was delivered out of the lion's mouth. God stood with me. And it's not that God waits for the storm to pass, for the pain to end, for the strife to come to a peaceful resolution. Nope. Even in the storm, even in the waves, even in the boat that is getting rocked and shaken, he is there. You remember when the apostles were on that sea? Notice the contrast in Matthew 14. The boat, by this time, was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves. Here's your contrast. The wind was against them. Where's God? He came to them. The wind is against them. Nature is against them. God came to them in the sea, in the boat, in the storm, and he is there. A present help in trouble. Keep your marker in Psalm 46. Go with me to Psalm 139. Keep your marker there. We're not going to have this one on the screen. Psalm 139. I want us to look at some words of David and ask a question that David asks. I want us to look at this question through the lens that you and I would look at today. Psalm 139, here's our question. Psalm 39, beginning in verse 139, beginning in verse 7. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the dawn, if I dwell in the remotest part of the sea, even there your hand will lead me, and your right hand will lay hold of me. Do you kind of get the question he's asking? If we go as far east as possible, standing on the Great Wall of China, would you be with me there? If I can go as high as possible, standing on the moon, if I could go as deep, plunging to the depths of the sea, he speaks even to the realm of the dead and Sheol, would you be with me there? Can you hear the questions we might ask with this in mind? Lord, if I have to go to the unemployment office, or the principal's office, or the police station, would you be with me there? If I have to go to the surgeon's office, the hospital, to the ICU, Lord, if I have to go to the nursing home, or the funeral home, or the graveside, would you be with me there? What's the answer in verse 10? Even there, even in your darkest time, even in the hardest place, hand by hand, we'll see this together. My hand will lead you. My right hand will take hold of you. A refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Do you think perhaps that's why David said that even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because even there you are with me. While the Lord may not shield us from every hurt and pain and storm in this life, he does not abandon us to face them alone. Part of the strength and the courage this psalmist found was the presence and every storm that is unwavering. Back in our psalm, we see the also living, the source of this courage is a place that is unmoved. There's a contrast given between verse 3 and then verse 4, if you look at the two. And verse 3, it's loud, it's wild, it's abusive. It is a 3-year-old child at 2 a.m. in the morning is screaming for water. It is chaos. But then verse 4 is peaceful and serene and gentle and welcoming. Verse 3 is a wild sea. And verse 4, it is the calm and gentle river. What God is saying is, there's a lot on earth, living on earth, that you're going to face, and it's going to make it rough. There's wars, there's fighting, there's death, there's sickness, there's disease, there's rebellion, there's murder and crime. But there is a place that exists that is not touched by the trouble on earth. Here he talks about God's city, the dwelling place of God in verse 4. And I would imagine if you were at this time and reading this psalm, you might think the city of God, like Jerusalem, where God's presence was, where the Ark of the Covenant stood. And there was a time, you remember in times past, when enemies would arrive around God's people and he would keep them safe. The Assyrians drew near and God protected his people, his place. I don't see that though when I read Psalm 46, at least not this side of the cross. When I read verse 4 and 5 and 6, I see a city whose foundations aren't set in stone. I don't see a capital that you can find on a map. I see a city that when elections and wars are taking place in other neighboring countries, it doesn't sweat. Then when storms and tornadoes and tsunamis and hurricanes come and are present, it is unmoved. I see the city that Abraham was looking for, the city which has foundations. And the reason that the city is firm, the reason these foundations stand, is because the architect and the builder is God. That's verse 5. The reason that this city he is describing is unmoved is because God is in the midst of her. She will not be moved. Where God is safe. Where God is protected. And his home, his dwelling place, his people are safe, are protected. That seems so foreign to us because everything we know changes. You drive by places, and I've heard it even from some of you today describing your hometown, how this used to be farmlands and it used to be a peaceful community, and now people are moving in and there's stores and there's communities and there's all these little tiny homes that people are trying to get in and move into. Things change. There was a language we used not long ago that we never used before. Quarantine and mask and social distancing. All we know is change. All we know is things that don't remain the same for very long. Either they get old or sick or tired or broken. But you know, there's a song, I was reminded it from one of the songs we sang tonight. And the aftermath of the Civil War, which was a time of great change, one of the hymns we sing a lot was written. And the words go like this: time is filled with swift transition. Naught of earth unmoved can stand. Build your hope on things eternal. Hold to. There is something that doesn't change. That there is a place that is unaffected by all the dangers and the challenges that you and I experience on a daily basis. You might ask, if you're reading this and going through this, that sounds great, but what help is that to me, because I'm on earth? I mean, heaven is protected and God's dwelling place is safe, but I'm not in heaven today. Well, don't miss the point. It's not just that he's saying that there's a place that's untouched and you're facing danger. What he's reminding us of is everything that you and I are living for, everything that we are building our lives towards, will not be tainted, will not be corrupted, will not become broken by the darkness that exists on earth. there's immense confidence in knowing not just that a place exists, but that place is my homeland. That's my citizenship. That's where I'm heading. That, if you want to take the language from Matthew 6 and verse 19, I've laid up my treasures there. Or from 1 Peter 1 and verse 4, that it's my hope and all that I'm looking for is reserved there. And there is nothing on earth that can touch or taint or wear or destroy there. And thus Jesus says, rejoice. Take great confidence in knowing your name is written there. You are guaranteed for there. You are heading there. And there is nothing on earth that can remove the confidence we have of arrival at home with God face to face. You and I can walk away from God. We can leave God and turn our back on Him. But no illness can change that. No governing power with all of their legislation can change that. No board of directors can have a say on that. Not even death can touch that. How do we sing it? No power of hell, no scheme of man can pluck me from His hand. For I am His and He is mine. I'm bought by the power of Christ or by the blood of Christ. That's where I stand. Can you feel the hope then? Heaven is not earth. And everything we long for, everything we hope for is safe and secure in the city of God, because that's where He is. The last source of confidence the psalmist points to is the power that is unmatched. In verse 8, he says, come, behold the works of the Lord. Such a powerful statement he gives. That in the times you feel confused and lost and don't really know what's going on and how to handle these conflicts, he says, I want you to consider what your God has done. I want you to look back and I want you to see your God and all of who He is and what He has done before, because what God has done is but a resume of always what it is He is able to do. So think of this. When Moses and the Israelites were on their way to the promised land and Pharaoh woke up and said, you know, free labor is kind of hard to find. Let's go get them back. And so there they are camped out against the Red Sea and the Egyptians are coming. Who defeated those Egyptians? Did you notice that language in verse 9? Who broke the bow and the chariots and the weaponry of the strongholds of the armies? Who parted that sea and provided that way? We talked yesterday. Who was it who saved Daniel from those lions? Or the friends from the fiery furnace? Who was it when the young man went up against the champion of the Philistines and gave the 16-year-old a strength to beat someone he shouldn't have beaten on his own? Who was it who saved the apostles in the storm which should have taken their lives? Who was it who, when the Savior was slain and the tomb was closed, opened that tomb to life and life eternal? Your God did. Your God did. Our God did. Did you hear what Russ said last night? The power of God is manifested over and over and over again for one purpose: to prove Himself to us. What God has done is but a resume of what He is over. Brethren, if God can rain bread from the sky and bring water out of a rock and make a path through water when before there was not one there, is there any problem or illness or sickness or conflict or pain that you and I could possibly face that He can't provide for? Something too great, too new, too challenging for our God to handle? That's the point of verse 8. I know our times are difficult and there's going to be situations you and I face that seem so confusing and we don't know the path forward. And what the psalmist says, I want you to look back and realize that God is your God. And if God delivers His people, if God can do the impossible, He can do the same for you and for I. And if I trust this, if I really believe in this God who was the God before, the God of David, the God of Moses, the God of Israel, if that is my God, then that's where verse 10 comes. Then be still. Be still. Cease striving. Stop worrying. Stop fretting about it. Calm that anxious heart. And trust that if God delivered his people before, he can do so again today. Do you remember the words we sing? It's an old song. Be still, my soul. The winds and waves still know his voice, who ruled them while he dwelt below. He still calms the seas today, brethren. He still moves mountains. Know that I am God, and be still. What I see when I read Psalm 46 is this. I see a soul that Satan is doing everything he can to crush and consume any ounce of faith and trust in his God. But the soul is unmoved because his God is unmoved and his God is with them in every storm he faces. I love the preacher man and I love his blog. And he wrote about some of the storms that go through Tennessee. And there was one storm in particular that went through a few years ago. And this is what our sister in Christ wrote. And I love so much that Ken shared it. She said, I remember a sunny day that began bright and sunny, but muggy and uncomfortable. That has been this week in Houston. Thank you. The weatherman predicted storms, but when one looked outside, it was hard to believe that it would happen. But by 3 p.m, things had changed drastically. The air was so humid, you felt that you would drown just walking through it. The sky in the west was turning ugly. Huge dark clouds were rolling in, and soon the sun was totally obliterated. It was almost as dark as night, but it was late afternoon. Suddenly, the clouds burst, and huge drops of rain began to fall. Lightning flashed through the heavens, and the house seemed to vibrate with each crash of thunder. The rain was so heavy, you couldn't see across the field and across the road. Rivers of water ran down our driveway into our backyard. There was a loud crack. And our power went off, and there was no more electricity for a while. We sat in darkness waiting for the storm to pass over, and little by little, the rain began to let up. The clouds lightened. The sun came out. Its rays were glistening in the light rain that still was falling. And then my daughter said it. Look, over the barn. Do you see it? Sure enough, there it was. A rainbow. We went outside standing in the drizzle to see it better. As we watched the colors, they all became brighter and brighter. It was beautiful. And then, just as we thought it couldn't get any better, a second rainbow appeared over the first, gradually darkening in color, just like the first. A sense of well-being flooded over me. Everything was going to be all right now. We had God's promise, and it was. It's hard sometimes to remember the hope we have in King Jesus when those waves are crashing against our faith. It's hard to fix our minds on things above when the things below are so terrible. But storms come and storms go. Hard times enter and hard times pass. And the beautiful thing about Psalms like Psalm 46 is that God has given us little echoes from heaven, reminding us of the promise that sees us through. Did you notice two times in our psalm that God is referred to as the God of Jacob? He's called it in verse 7 and in verse 11. The God of Jacob. Does that seem strange to you? It's a unique name. It's oddly specific. Often we hear referred to as the God of Abraham or the God of Israel. Or the God of a nation, right? The God of the Old Testament. But the God of Jacob. Why Jacob? Well, Jacob was a man of faith for sure. In fact, Jacob believed what's at the heart of this psalm. And there's a statement in Genesis 35 and verse 3 where Jacob said, let us arise and go to Bethel so that I may make there an altar to the God who answers me in the day of my distress and has always been with me wherever I have gone. He's a man of great faith and trusted in the provision and the presence of God. Jacob and his father and his grandfather are forever known by their faith. They are known as the heirs of God's incredible promise. And so the name, the God of Jacob, is simply a way of saying this is a faithful God, a God who keeps his word, a God who keeps his promises. That may not sound like much, but I will tell you, this will make all the difference. We're ending right here, and I just need you for one moment. There is a promise that God gives in Psalm 46 that you're going to need desperately, because I have needed this promise over and over again. That in the times we are driven to our knees and we don't know the way forward, we feel so lost and confused and hurting, we don't know where to turn or where the answer is, there is a time in that moment most desperate that we need to look down and to look at your hand and remember the five words your God has promised to you. I will never leave you. I will never leave you. But I don't know where to go. I'll never leave you. But everyone has turned their back on me. I will never leave you. But the doctor says it's serious this time. I will never leave you. I don't have any more answers, Lord. I don't even know what to ask. I will never leave you. Not in disease, not in divorce, not in death. I will never leave you. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Thank you for listening so well, my brethren. Let's take a short break, and we'll be back soon.
Let's be coming to our seats, please, so we can begin the second lecture. Our brother David Banning has done something that among preachers is very unique. He has gone back and is doing his local work at the church where he grew up. I mean, just has gone against even what Jesus said about a prophet not being without honor except in his hometown. Well, David is with honor at the Kleinwood Church, and we're so pleased to have David and Heidi in our company this week preaching about what the Scripture says. And his topic tonight, what does the Scripture say about baptism? Now, David, I don't want to put any pressure on you, but I feel like you should know that here at Southside, for this very lecture, our deacons just put in a brand new baptistry behind me. And we are anticipating the day of Pentecost when David extends the invitation tonight. People need to hear, don't they? And they need to know that what the apostles preached is the same scripture that we preach about baptism. Brother Tim's going to lead us in a song, then we look forward to hearing from our brother David Banning.
We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 3, followed by the chorus. A new creature. Go for I think it was about 3 weeks ago that I started getting some unfamiliar email in my mailbox, which typically I just delete without looking. I'm glad I didn't, because they were from you guys. And then after that, I started getting some letters in the mail that weren't asking me to send any money to them. They were from you guys too. And the first day I got here, one of your young men came up to me and gave me another letter, and all of them were about the same thing, that you guys were preparing for this week, and you were encouraging us, and you were excited about us coming. I want to tell you that that does a couple of things. One of the things it does is it says to those of us who participate, you guys are getting ready for this. And we really appreciate that. And Russ is nodding. You're probably going to agree with this too, right? It really kind of puts some burden on you, doesn't it? Think, man, I need to get myself together. And we need to do good work this week. And I hope that's happening. I love that sort of upward spiral that creates as you guys get involved. And it encourages us. And I think it ups the level of our work. And hopefully to the end that it will bring glory to God. I hope so. But I wanted you to know that I think all of us are really grateful for that correspondence. Back before I started preaching, I had this coworker that I discovered was interested in the scriptures. And once I figured that out, he and I started talking, and I found that he actually was really, really interested in scripture and read it all the time. And so when it worked out that we would be like in the lunchroom at the same time, when we could get a moment free, we would talk about the Bible all the time. And we just talked about all kinds of things because he was really, as I said, interested in all of that. And so I sort of worked the conversation around to salvation. Y'all see where that's going, right? I had an agenda in this. And so we started talking about that. I learned he was a Calvinist, and so many a lunch break was spent sort of talking about all of that. And then I remember one day, just about the time lunch was over, we were packing up our stuff to go back to our offices, and as we did that, I said, "So tell me what you think about baptism." And so I remember literally as we started walking down the hall, this guy says to me, "Oh, that's easy. I can do that real quick." He said, "Baptism is nice, but not necessary." And that was his slogan. He had sort of come up with this little slogan that was for him the way he explained baptism. And as we walked along, he went ahead and explained what he meant when he said that. He said, "Listen, I think baptism is a really cool thing to do." He said, "In fact, I was baptized after I was saved. Several months later, I had this ceremony. I invited family, I invited friends, and we celebrated the fact that I had accepted Christ and he was my Savior." And he said, "That's very meaningful to me." But he said, "Let me be crystal clear about something. I do not believe that that is something a person has to do to be saved." And so I knew at that moment what our next topic would be over lunch. We were going to start talking about baptism. Well, it is Tuesday night, and you're in a church building, and this is the second lecture. So I'm imagining that I'm talking to some people, maybe a lot of people, who have had a conversation that sounded something like that, right? We do live in a world, and I even mean in a religious world, where most people have never heard anything that would make them attach any significance to baptism at all. And so when we start talking to people, I think they're a little curious about that. In fact, I've had people ask me this. Maybe they've asked you this too. I've had people say, "Why do you guys make such a big deal about that?" And it is to them kind of strange. So really what I'd like to do tonight is answer that question. And please know that it isn't lost on me that it is Tuesday night and we're sitting in a church building and you stayed for a second lecture advertised as a lecture about baptism. We're going to get a gold star on the way tonight, on the way out tonight for that. But I have to tell you, I'm a bit of a realist. And I know if I'm sitting where you are and the preacher got up and said, I'm going to preach a lesson on baptism, I think in my brain I would be saying, I've kind of covered that ground before. And I am not sure that you're really going to have anything to say about that, that I haven't heard before, that I need to hear. So knowing that's the way I would think, and maybe, well, I'll think higher of you. Maybe there's one out there that would be where I am. Can I give you two reasons to hang with me for this next little bit? Ken told us last night about our mission. And I think if we're going to be faithful to our mission, and we're going to share his message, in our world, we're going to have to talk about this. We're going to have to answer that question. In fact, most of our conversations about baptism are not casual, like my conversation with my coworker. Most of the time, when we are talking to someone about baptism, it is at a very crucial moment in their journey. Do you buy that? Do you see that? And so I think if we could equip ourselves to be able to talk really well about this, scripturally about this, I think as we go about our mission, this was going to be useful to us. I hope that maybe among all the things you already know, we can drop something in tonight that will help you at someone's crucial point in their journey when you need to talk about baptism. The second thing that I would ask you to consider is the value of re-plowing old ground. I had a young guy who was interning to preach, and he'd been asked by the elders to do a sermon on baptism, and he didn't want to complain to them, so he called and complained to me, and he said, I don't know what to do with this assignment. I have nothing to say that hasn't been said before better than I'm going to say it. In fact, I just recently heard a preacher say that, you know, this stuff we've talked about again and again and again, we've got that settled. We don't need to talk about that anymore. We need to move on to other stuff. And I'm going to tell you, folks, as soon as we stop talking about it, we're going to have a problem with it and need to talk about it again. That's what I told this young man. I said, you know, there is value in going back over the things that we do know and reaffirming those things and solidifying that foundation. And I got to tell you, when he got done preaching that sermon, I'm not setting y'all up when I say this, but the crowd was thrilled with it. And we're encouraged by it. And listen, if I can just make you feel as convinced as ever tonight that you did what the Lord wanted you to do, when you obeyed the gospel and were baptized for the remission of your sins, that's a good purpose, don't you think? And so that the two ideas I have in mind for this lesson tonight, let's think about talking to other people, and let's think about keeping our own foundation secure. Now, to do that, I want to start off by taking some stuff off the table, because sometimes when we talk about baptism, we go off onto some tangents that aren't relevant to the discussion. And so let me take a couple of things off the table. Let me say to you, first of all, that we are not talking about this because it is popular to talk about baptism. Someone's saying, why in the world did he say that? That is absolutely obvious. That didn't even need to be said. And you're right about that. It is not popular to talk about that. In fact, most people think we're a little strange because of what we say about baptism. Some people even believe that what we teach about baptism is false doctrine, that we're teaching salvation by works. That's another sermon for another night, but that accusation is made. And so I think the truth of the matter is we would fit in better with our religious community if we'd stop talking about this. Just leave it alone. And so it seemed to me that this is a really good place to remind all of us that our concern is not with fitting culture and with saying things that are going to that will please culture. Our concern is with
pleasing the Lord. Here's the thing that I want you to see about that. If that is what we are determined to do, to please the Lord, to do what He wants us to do, to say what He wants us to say, what we are going to find is that culture is going to be less and less and less tolerant of that. They're not going to like what we have to say. We will be out of step with the people around us. And so, I think you and I need to resist the temptation to sort of tweak the message of the gospel to make it more palatable to our world. Please hear me on this, brothers and sisters. The gospel has never been palatable to the world. Never will be. And if we try to do that, we're going to wake up one day and realize we're not preaching the gospel anymore. This is not about embracing something that's popular or make us more acceptable. It's about pleasing the Lord. Second thing I want to take off the table is this. We are not trying to say that baptism is the only thing that matters. Anybody ever said that to you before? I think to some degree, that is a point of confusion that is unavoidable, because for most people, we are introducing something to a conversation about salvation that for them has not been part of the conversation. And so I think when we start talking about it, when they've never even considered it, it sounds really loud. They really, really hear that. And so can we just be clear about this? This process of a sinner coming to a holy God and having a relationship with Him. This process, folks, it has lots and lots of pieces. There are some pieces of this that are just God's pieces. What He did for us and Jesus Christ by His grace and mercy, that is God's stuff. And some part of this are just God's things. But there are some parts for us too, and some things that He's asked from us as well. Here's what I want to say about that. Exactly what I said Monday morning about the stuff that's in the Bible. All of that's important. Whether it's something that God did or something He wants me to do, and it's involved in this process of me coming to have a relationship with a holy God, all of that's important. So we are not trying to elevate one piece of the process before another. I need to be concerned about all of it. And the last thing I want to say is that this is not about our tradition. Because I think that's what some people think. You know, every church is a little weird about something. And people think, yeah, we're all kind of weird about instruments and baptism, right? And what I worry is that maybe sometimes our young people grow up and kind of see it that way too. We're just kind of strange about this baptism thing. That is just our tradition. So I really want to be clear about that. Baptism is a common practice among us, right? But we don't baptize people just because we've always done that. In fact, let me be clear. I've never heard a preacher say that. I've never been in a church anywhere where one of the members said, well, you know, we only do this baptism thing because, well, that's just what we've always done ever since I could remember. Tradition doesn't have anything to do with it. So why do we make such a big deal about baptism? What is it about? Well, I mean, since we're talking about what the Scriptures say, can I just say it's about Scripture? When I go to my Bible, it's there. So let's be clear about something. When you're talking to your religious friends, remember, we didn't impose baptism on the Scripture. It's not like that wasn't part of the conversation. All of a sudden, we decide we're going to insert it. The reality is that you and I go to our Bible, and when we read it, baptism is there. Can I illustrate that for you real quick? Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. Matthew 28 and verse 19. As Jesus He's commissioning His disciples to go preach the gospel. He tells them to baptize. So Jesus talked about it. And then we'll come back to that in a minute, but I'm going to look ahead to Acts chapter 2 on Pentecost. Now, Peter is preaching, and on Acts 2, when Peter preached on Pentecost, he talked in verse 38 about baptism too. And then we get to the letters, the epistles that follow the book of Acts. And we find baptism there. It's in Romans 6. Romans chapter 6. It's in Galatians 3 in verse 27. All of you have been baptized into Christ, have clothed yourself with Christ. There's the one baptism of Ephesians chapter 4, in 1 Peter 3 in verse 21. Baptism now saves you. And so you can't read your New Testament with just out stumbling across baptism as you make your way through. In fact, by one counting, there are 100 references to baptism in the New Testament. So again, we are not making baptism part of the conversation. God already did that. And it just seems to me, brothers and sisters, if we go back to what we were talking about on Monday, and we're interested in hearing what God has to say, that when it comes to this topic, we should want to hear what he has to say as well. Now, there's something else I'm curious about. Because it isn't just that it's there. We open the Bible and baptism is there. The other thing I'm kind of curious about is the fact that baptism keeps popping up in interesting places. Have you ever thought about that? Remember, my friend's attitude was that baptism is really somewhat of a trivial matter. It's a nice thing to do if you want to, but you don't have to do it. I think much of the religious world is really kind of ambivalent about it. Some even go further than that, and they say, you know, it was just kind of an ancient ritual, a first century thing, not really relevant to people who are living today. And if that is so, I am curious about the places it keeps popping up in the New Testament. So I pointed you to Matthew 28 a minute ago. Will you look back at that text, Matthew 28? Will you think about what's going on here at the end of Matthew's gospel? What's he doing? The very last words of Matthew's record, he's recording the commissioning of Jesus to his disciples to go preach the gospel. Take what you've learned about me and what I've done. Go tell everybody about that. I think that's a pretty big deal, folks. And right in the middle of this commissioning, he tells his disciples, in fact, you ever thought about how much space baptism occupies in this little brief text? All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. Lo, I'm with you always, even till the end of the age. And that's the end of it. Right there, at that critical moment, Jesus is talking about baptism. Does that not strike you as an odd place for something that really isn't that important? And it doesn't get better as we keep going through the text. If you look at Acts chapter 2, what's going on in Acts 2? It's Pentecost. Did you take Phil Roberts for Bible? Remember what he said about Acts 2? Called it the hub of the whole Bible. I think he was right about that. I mean, it's just one of the greatest, most important, pivotal chapters in the Bible story. The Holy Spirit's fallen on the apostles. Great miracle has taken place. A crowd has gathered. A crowd of thousands has gathered. And Peter's up there preaching to them. And the crowd is convicted by his preaching. Thousands are going to respond to that day. But verse 37, guys, is the critical moment. You see at the end of verse 37, we know he's reached his audience, because his audience, convicted of their sin, says, what do we do? I mean, it is difficult for me to imagine a more monumental moment in the story, right? They're here, they're ready. And you know what he says to them, verse 38, right? You guys are ahead of me. Peter said to them, repent. And let each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And we have folks saying, That baptism is just this trivial, unimportant detail, just a first century custom, not even relevant to people today. And at this pivotal moment, there it is. It's right there in the story. And listen, if you keep on going through Acts, that's what we see over and over and over again. Keep making your way. You know, Acts is this wonderful book that just takes us on a journey with those early workers as they did what Jesus told them to do in Matthew 28. They're preaching the gospel to everybody. And what I love about Acts is you get all these stories about people making their way to Jesus, going through the process. And yet, you know what's interesting? What comes up again and again and again in the process? I mean, just over and over again, we're told about their baptism. I think about Acts 8. This is one of the stories that stands out to me. In Acts 8, remember the conversion of the Ethiopian eunuch? The Spirit sends Philip to meet up with this guy, and he joins him in the chariot. I love the end of verse 35. Isn't this just simply what we do? He says he preached Jesus to him. You see that? But here's the interesting thing. Do you see what is the next recorded response by the eunuch? Verse 36. As he went along the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch says, look, water, what prevents me from being baptized? Isn't that interesting? I tried to think about how long this Bible study in the chariot was. I don't think it was like a four-week thing, do you? I'm thinking maybe a couple of hours they've done this. Is that reasonable? So let's just imagine. Philip has talked to this guy for a couple of hours. I don't know anything about the sermon other than the part that led up to the beginning of it, right? I don't know anything about the sermon. But I do know that at some point along the way, this eunuch sees water and he says, I want to get baptized. Why can't I do that? Do you think there was something in the sermon about baptism? How could there not have been? And not just something about it, but something that made him earnestly want to do that. You know what bothers me about that? I'm going to tell you what, folks. You can sit in a lot of churches all over this country for years, and you can sit there your whole life and never hear anything that'd make you say, what do I have to do to be baptized? And I think if that's the case, we need to pause and consider, is there a different message that's being preached today than what Philip preached to the eunuch? And we're not done. We can jump ahead to Acts chapter 10, verse 47. You know what's going on in Acts 10, right? That's an important one too, because this is the Gentile, Cornelius, who is now hearing the gospel. Man, this is getting ready to open up a huge front in the story, right? There's a whole new group of people that are going to be included in this. It's a big, big story. And you know what's in that story? Baptism is. Because when the Spirit fell on them, Peter got it. He understood. He said, who can refuse water for these to be baptized too? It just seems odd to me. And a baptism is just this irrelevant detail, this unimportant thing. And it just keeps popping up over and over again. One of the most interesting spots you find baptism is in the book of Romans. Because a lot of our religious friends believe Romans is the place you go to prove salvation by faith only, to prove those baptism folks wrong. In fact, there's some of you are old enough to remember the old Roman road that our denominational friends used to talk about. I heard a guy explaining the Roman road one time, and when he got to chapter 6, there was just a pothole right there. He left right over Romans 6, didn't even talk about it, and I know why. It's a problem for the theory. Paul talks about baptism there. As I was looking over this material for tonight, I imagine that by this point y'all would be getting frustrated with me because I know this isn't the important thing that I mean it's important, it's in the scripture, the context is important, but the really important thing isn't just that it's there and it's in an interesting context, right? And you've been waiting for me to get that. Because what is important is what is actually said in the text about baptism. And I want to be clear. It is not for me to say what baptism is about. It's in the book because the Lord put it here. And it's in these places because the Lord wanted it in these places. And in those places, he said something about it. And what is interesting is when you start digging around, the Lord is crystal clear what he had in mind when he made baptism part of his plan. And all we have to do is look at these passages to see that. Can you go back to Matthew 28 then? I'm just going to kind of keep running through these same passages. In Matthew 28 and verse 19, Jesus tells us, this is how you make disciples. You baptize them. It's interesting that in Mark 16, y'all knew I had to quote Mark 16, right? In Mark 16, Mark's really doing the same thing that Matthew did in Matthew 28. Mark is kind of wrapping this thing up with the mission to go spread the gospel. In Mark 16 and verse 15, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. So there it is, the mission of disciples. Go tell everyone about this. But look what he says in 16. He who has believed and has been baptized shall be saved, but he who has disbelieved shall be condemned. You know, I've been reading that since I started preaching 40 years ago. I got to tell you, I just don't know how folks miss that. I have sometimes pondered in my mind, Bubba, if the Lord wanted to make it more clear, what would he have said differently than what he said in this text? What is baptism for? Is for salvation. And Peter says that. Go ahead to the text we looked at in Acts chapter 2. Peter says the same thing in Acts 2 and verse 38. Repent and let each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. What's it for? It is for the forgiveness of sins. People are baptized to be saved. Acts 22:16. Arise, Saul was told, and be baptized and wash away your sins. And then there is that text in Romans 6. Will you look at that one? To you good Roman students out there, let me just put this admission on the table. I know that Romans chapter 6 is not an essay on baptism. I really do know that. What is Romans 6 about? Verse 1. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin so that grace may increase? Paul, as he does in this letter, is anticipating an objection and answering it before they can get it out of their mouth. But the answer is interesting. Because what he says, it may it never be. How shall we who died to sin still live in it? He said, you can't do that. You can't keep on sinning so God can be gracious and merciful to you. That doesn't even work. Why? Because you died to sin. And then he talks about how that happened. Are you still there? Look at verse 3. Or do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Well, there's a whole sermon to be preached here about how what we do in baptism parallels the death of Jesus. It's a beautiful figure that he's working here. But look at verse 4. Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. Did you see what he's saying there? He's saying that at baptism, a death occurs. In fact, some of you guys are old enough to remember when the preachers used to talk about the watery grave, right? That's what it is, man. We're put down in that watery grave, and he says we're raised to walk in newness of life. When you're raised up, you walk in this new life. Verse 5, for if we become united with him in the likeness of his death, when we're baptized, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. I love verse 6. Knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him. You see what he's saying there? There's a death that takes place when you're baptized. It's when we make that choice that we decide, I'm killing the old man. That's what he means when he said, how can you who died to sin still live in it? In order that the body of sin might be done away with, so that we will no longer be slaves of sin. Listen to verse 7. Here it is. For he who has died is freed from sin. I want to be free of my sins. How do I do it? Paul says you got to die. What does he mean? Die with Christ in baptism. That is a compelling argument for the purpose of baptism. You'll hear all kinds of things today about what baptism is for. Surely you've heard someone say baptism is an outward sign of an inward grace. It's something we do to show other people that we've accepted Christ as our Savior. Something we do after to celebrate our salvation, like my friend did. It's a nice ritual if you want to do it. Some are not that kind about it. Some would say ancient practice from a long, long time ago, not relevant in our time. Let me say two things about all of this. Number one, the Lord weighed in on this, brothers sisters. And number two, he didn't say any of that. What did he say? In baptism, you die with Jesus. You kill the old man. Your sins are forgiven. You're freed. You're raised to walk a new life. But I would add this last thought. I don't think anybody who knows the broader Bible story should be surprised to find water in God's plan. You know, Russ last night did a masterful job taking us back to Genesis and Exodus and saying to us things like, it isn't just the story. There's lessons there about God. So I'm going to rip you off right in front of your face. And say one of the lessons, as you find in Genesis, Exodus, about God, is that he uses water all the time. In Genesis chapter 6, when the world was overwhelmed with sin, God overwhelmed the world with water and cleaned the place up. And then in Exodus chapter 14, as Israel is exiting slavery and bondage in Egypt, they pass through the water, right, to leave bondage in Egypt. And then in Exodus chapter 30, now I'm getting a little bit ahead of where you were, right? In Exodus 30, when they're at Mount Sinai and they build the tabernacle, one of the pieces of furniture that they're told to construct is this big basin, the laver, that was to be set in front of the door of the tabernacle into the holy place, a big basin that held, guess what? Water, so that the priests, when they rendered service to God, could first wash themselves and purify themselves so that they could go serve before the Lord. And then in Joshua chapter 3, at the end of the wilderness wandering, when they leave the desert and go into the promised land, again, they pass through water. Folks, it isn't just that there was a lot of water to get around in that part of the world. God uses water. So why would any of us be surprised? Under the new covenant, when we are transferred from the kingdom of darkness out of the bondage of sin into his kingdom, why would we be surprised that water is wrapped up in that process? It's not about traditions, what we've always done. It's not about what's popular or what others are doing. It's what we've been talking about all week. In his book, God said something about baptism. And what we want to do is listen to his voice so we can do what he said. I wonder in this crowd if maybe there's somebody that already understands the part that God did for us in Jesus. And maybe you even understand what part he wants you to play in this, to put your trust in his son and be committed to his path. And maybe all that remains for you is that you need to die. I have no idea what Bubba meant when he talked about a Pentecost moment, because there are not 3,000 people here. But I can tell you this, If you've never died with Jesus and been raised to that new life, and you're struggling with that, the God of heaven cares about what you do tonight. Of all the people in the world, the eyes of heaven are on you. And he's hoping that tonight you'll decide, I'm going to die so that I can really live. I'm going to do what God said to do in his book. I'm going to be baptized for the remission of my sins. There is a brand new baptistry waiting for you to break it in. Would you do that tonight? Song is designed to encourage you. Come down to this front bench right now while we stand, while we sing together.
God's invitation remains open, and if we can help and assist you and serve you in any way this night, no matter the hour of the night, all you need to do is let us know, because the gospel of Jesus Christ is for all. That's what the scriptures say. Can you believe we're halfway over? Two full days remain. And we invite your participation and your continued interest as we think about what the scriptures say this week. Brother Stevens will lead a final song to dismiss. And then Joe, if you'll come and lead our closing prayer, Joe Scarborough. Thank you again for being with us. God bless you.
Christ lives in me.
Let's all pray together. Our God and our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Father, we are very thankful that we have had this time to come together in this place to hear your word preached so eloquently. We pray that we would take these words that we've been heard and apply them to our lives, take them and internalize them, and live our life daily by your word and the things that we know to be true. Thank you, Father, for this time we've come together. We've offered our songs of praise to your name, and we pray that those songs have been acceptable to your sight. Thank you, Father, for being with us here this evening. Help us all get home safely. Bring us all back here tomorrow night for some more good preaching, good singing, and help us all to live our lives according to your will. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, and amen.